My name is Allison Leigh, and this is a presentation for the American Men's Studies Association Conference 2021. I'll be presenting a talk entitled Edouard Manet's Syphilis, Painting, Debility, and Adaptation in the 1880s. In late August or early September of 1882, the French painter Edouard Manet wrote a letter which is revealing in terms of his health and general outlook. Quote, "What a dreadful month, rain or wind every day. It doesn't make the countryside any more pleasant, especially for an invalid. I shall have to be very patient, seeing that I may extend my stay until the end of October. I'd like to try to come back somewhat recovered." Manet wrote this letter while recuperating from a decline in his health that most scholars believe resulted from syphilis, an affliction he had likely contracted some 15 or 20 years earlier. The importance of Manet's reference to himself as a quote-unquote invalid should not be underestimated. Yet the exact nature of the artist's increasing debility and its effect on his identity as a man has never been clearly established. The work I'd like to introduce you to today seeks to establish the types of formal changes which took place in this artist's work in the last years of his life. It will also challenge assumptions long held in art history about how the kind of infirmity Manet suffered from intersected with ideals of masculinity in the 19th century. For scrutinizing Manet's practice across the decades, and I'm showing you now some of his most famous works, will reveal that he not only resisted the debilitating effects of syphilis, but morphed his painting practice so that he might preserve his identity as a gentleman flâneur, despite his increasing infirmity. First, it's important to note that the illness to which Manet refers in the letter I opened with has been variously alluded to and sometimes glossed over in the scholarship of the last 100 years. Most recent historians have been forthcoming about the artist's syphilitic condition. In the book on the upper left, the art historian Albert Boehm stated that Manet was, quote, quite ill from the effects of syphilis in his last years. Similarly, the editors of the volume on the lower right state clearly that the painter was suffering from, quote, a degenerative disorder of the nervous system associated with tertiary syphilis. Manet himself alluded to his condition in various ways. In a letter from 1880, written while he was undergoing a thermal cure at Bellevue, he described emotional ups and downs. And in another letter from that same summer, he stated unequivocally, quote, "I am prepared to undergo any discomfort in order to regain my health." More often, though, Manet brushed off the seriousness of his condition, frequently claiming he was feeling, quote, much better, and at one point even arguing that extending his stay in Bellevue for treatments did not mean that he was feeling worse, but that, quote, on the contrary, I am doing better and better. Along similar lines, when a report describing him as gravely ill appeared in the French periodical L'Evénement in 1882, Manet immediately issued a correction, stating, quote, "Your morning columns contain a bulletin concerning my health, which, however sympathetic, is inaccurate. I am not ill. I simply sprained my foot before leaving Paris." This was printed only 2 days after the original notice appeared, showing the eagerness with which Manet sought to correct public perception. The reality was that he had been in serious physical decline since 1875, when he first began experiencing pain in his legs. By 1880, he had begun to drag his left leg, and he was forced to use a cane. He was diagnosed with locomotor ataxia, then a common designation for the neurological symptoms associated with tertiary syphilis, the signs of which could vary greatly from complications of the cardiovascular system to skin rashes and pains in the lower extremities. Descriptions left by his contemporaries make it clear that this pain forced Manet to have to begin painting from a seated position. A fellow artist reported Manet's apologies for not standing up when he visited his studio in 1882. Quote, "He recognized me at once, held out his hand and said, 'I'm so sorry, please forgive me. I must remain seated. I'm having difficulties with my foot.'" Another close friend, the journalist Antonin Proust, described similar struggles. Quote, "He was walking with difficulty and came to see me only with huge efforts." Such increasing physical impairments can be seen reflected in his artistic practice as well. Evaluating the format Manet chose for his paintings over time demonstrates a dramatic shift in the second half of the 1870s. I performed a large-scale data assessment using the artist's catalog raisonné in combination with digital humanities tools to try to better assess these changes as they occurred over time. Now, in art history, catalog raisonnés are books which provide a comprehensive listing of all the known artworks by specific artists. And this is what the raw data looks like in these kinds of books. I transferred all of this information into a very large spreadsheet, and analyzing the data on a comprehensive scale allowed me to see that whereas some 85% of his canvases were painted horizontally in 1871, and 60% were horizontal in 1876, that number drops to only 8% the following year. And remember that 1875 is when Proust claimed Manet began to have pain in his legs. This can be visualized slightly differently. If you look at the works he made between 1863 and 74, you see that Manet painted most of his canvases in a horizontal format, about 61%. But then between 1877 and 83, when the pain in his legs was increasing, the percentage of horizontal canvases decreases sharply to only 24%. Painting from a seated position would have made it easier to adjust canvases perpendicularly. Easels in Manet's time often had a lever like this one, which would have allowed him to move a vertical canvas up and down, as opposed to standing and moving his chair each time he needed to paint a different section of a large horizontal work. But painting from a seated position and not being able to freely walk the streets as he had for so many years must have been a painful adjustment. Several scholars describe the importance of Manet's activity as a flâneur to his overall identity. And he was frequently discussed in his own time for the way his gait gave him a special elegance. Proust wrote that, quote, "Manet had an alluring cadence, which his hip-swinging gait imprinted with a particularly elegant character." While the writer George Moore noted the way his shoulders, quote, "swaggered as he went across a room." Not being able to walk as he once had, and the new forced reliance on a cane were both painful signs of his increasing infirmity. Further, an episode reported by Proust provides strong evidence that Manet was self-conscious about the visibility of his impairment. Proust tells us in his memoir of the artist that Manet once visited a hat shop with him, and the female milliner offered a chair when she saw that he was leaning on his cane. To this, Manet responded gruffly, quote, "I have no need of a chair. I am not impotent." Proust further describes Manet's inability to let the incident go. Even after returning to his studio, Manet was still saying to Proust, quote, "Imagine wanting to pass me off as a legless cripple in front of all the women who were there." The critic Adolphe Tabarin also described how Manet, despite his pain by late 1881, was continually visiting the Folies Bergères nightclub he would come to so famously paint. According to Tabarin, he was constantly, quote, "sketching the decor while moving agonizingly around the promenades." All of this paints a picture of a man desperately trying to keep up appearances and resist the outward signs of his deterioration. For Manet, being seen as a gentleman who struggled to walk meant that he would be viewed as, in his own words, un coup de jatte, a legless cripple. Such judgment was unacceptable to him, no matter the reality of his growing bodily weakness. When Manet sharply countered the offer of a chair with the declaration that he was not impotent, he made clear that his disability had come to threaten his masculine identity and his gendered sense of himself in the world. This danger to his male ego could be countered with sharp words like the redaction he sent to Lavinmont and by appearing in his usual haunts as Tabarin describes. There was perhaps no greater arena in which he could reclaim his presence as a man than through his painting practice. For while he may have been forced to paint more canvases in a vertical format, the data on Manet's oeuvre also reveals a tremendous surge in productivity at the end of his life. Just when one might expect his illness to have forced him to reduce the amount he worked, Manet pushed against such circumstances and ramped up his production. Between 1879 and 83, Manet made 139 paintings, more than at any other time in his life. In fact, the next nearest five-year period is quite far from the rate at which he began canvases in his last years. Further, averaging all the years of his work before his illness reveals that Manet produced about 11 paintings a year, thus making his last full year of painting in 1882 an increase of 230% compared to his normal average rate. Looking at the data in this way reveals that painting served a similar purpose to his declaration that he was not impotent. By painting more than he ever had before, Manet could keep up appearances and bolster the version of his masculinity that he had projected in years before the complications from syphilis arose. For Manet, making 37 paintings in 1879, 36 in 1880, and 37 again in 1882, was a means of shoring up his manhood against the repressive reality of his own body's breakdown. The same was true of the pictures he submitted for public exhibition in the prestigious Paris Salon. More of his canvases were exhibited in the exhibitions between 1879 and 83 than in any other five-year period in his life. These painterly efforts proved similar to the letters he wrote professing that he was getting better and better, and the newspaper correction in which he proclaimed, "I am not ill." We should keep in mind that in these last years, when he had more paintings accepted to the Salon exhibition than in any others, he was undergoing painful treatments in the summers, and he was barely able to walk unassisted. Without question, such astonishing productivity should recalibrate our sense of what an artist who is suffering from a painful debility can achieve. The reality is that Manet fought the effects of his disease, projecting instead a sense of masculine assuredness and capability. And he did this while adapting in subtle ways to his condition so that he might prolong his ability to work. Despite these efforts, however, his illness overwhelmed him in the spring of 1883. By April of that year, his left foot had become black and swollen, and his doctors decided an amputation was necessary. His leg was apparently in a deplorable state. Gangrene had set in, and his toenails came away upon contact. To the end, Manet was hopeful for a recovery, telling the doctors to perform the operation so that he might be done with it and get back to his paintings. Even so, Manet died on April 30th, 10 days after the operation. What I hope this excerpt from my larger research project has revealed today are the ways that Manet's physical impairments intersected with his masculine identity and the artistic persona which grew from it. The intensity of Manet's work ethic proves that despite extraordinary impediments, artists have a remarkable ability to adapt, even in the face of terrible pain. Thank you.